Although the radio that I just described will work, it would have some interesting properties. First of all, there's no way to tune into one particular radio station. If you happen to use this radio and you had two radio transmitters an equal distance from you, transmitting at the same power, then you would hear both of the radio stations at the same time overlapping one another in the headphones. If one of the radio stations were a little bit further away, of course, then you would still hear that radio station too, but the volume would be reduced. So what we need to do in order to improve this particular radio receiver is to include a way to tune it. There's no frequency selection in the original circuit. One way to include a little bit of radio selection would be to merely use a single inductor. An antenna, like the one I have here, that is a relatively short antenna, is actually capacitive. So if you combine an antenna with an inductor, you can create a resonance. That is, the capacitor in the antenna combined with an inductor in the circuit can function as a resonant element, in other words, a filter. And it would give you, if you had a tunable inductor, some way of filtering out all the frequencies that you don't want. It wouldn't be a very good filter, but it would at least allow you some tuning on the radio dial. A better way to do it would be to include both a capacitor and an inductor in the circuit, as what I'm showing here. Later in this class, I'll describe how an antenna can behave as a capacitor. If an antenna is long, it actually behaves like an inductor. So if the antenna is too long, it won't work like I just described. But because we're at very low frequency, it turns out that antennas are normally capacitive. You would have to make an antenna really, really long, like over 100 meters long, in order for the antenna to start to behave like an inductor. So a filter, which you'll learn about soon in this course, consists of a capacitor and an inductor in series, or a capacitor and an inductor in parallel. And if we look at several different design variations for radio receivers, then you'll see that what all of these circuits have in common are inductors and capacitors, either in series or in parallel. And that allows tuning of the circuit. And some of these designs are really interesting. For example, you can use a directional loop antenna. You can just take a loop of wire and loop it around over and over and over again, and use that loop of wire as an antenna, hook it up to a tunable capacitor, and you have a way to naturally filter out the radio stations that you don't want and get good tuning. Or you can use a tunable capacitor. All of these circuits have diodes, and that diode, again, is really important in order to demodulate the signal. This type of radio is called a crystal radio. All of the diodes in the circuits that I've just shown you and the diode in the circuit that I started with is a type of crystal. So crystal in this title refers to a diode. When people first started making crystal radios, they didn't have diodes. A diode, like a silicon diode or a germanium diode, is a semiconductor diode, and semiconductors didn't come until later. For example, the mid part of the 20th century. But it's possible to make another kind of diode called a Schottky diode by just pressing a piece of metal against an appropriate rock or mineral. And one commonly used material was called galena. So if you have a galena diode, meaning a piece of metal in contact with galena, then current flows more readily in one direction than another direction. So just making a very simple circuit like that would allow demodulation. The crystal radio was patented in 1906, and I'm showing now the original diagram in that patent. And I think it's very interesting to look at some of the circuit symbols that they had back then. The inductor looks something like the symbol for a modern resistor. These are actually inductors, and the symbol for a capacitor was also rather interesting too. It doesn't look anything like the modern symbol for a capacitor. There was no symbol for a diode. We just simply have the rock and the point contact. And the earpiece was a little circle. So all of the functionality of this crystal radio circuit that was in that original patent is identical to the functionality of the circuit that I've just shown you. The tuning is provided by the capacitor and inductor. The antenna receives the signal, the rock and the point contact demodulate the signal, and then the high impedance earphones receive it. This is an image of a crystal radio from Popular Science, published in 1925. We can see that the inductor was approximately the size of a toilet paper tube. Right here in the center of the diagram, we're looking at a tunable capacitor that was used for tuning. Here we're seeing the point contact or the diode. And then these knobs are where the earth, ground, and the antenna could be connected. This is an image of what one of these circuits would have actually looked like. It's interesting because some of these tube radios in the 1920s, that is, radios using vacuum tubes, were really expensive. So the crystal radio, or this type of radio, was actually really common even after the invention of the vacuum tube, just because the vacuum tubes were so expensive, or vacuum tube radios were so expensive. What you might have noticed with these receiver circuits is that no power supply was necessary. There was no battery on these circuits. The human ear is so sensitive that the power in the radio wave itself is used to drive the diaphragm in the speaker just enough that the human ear is able to hear the sound that comes out. And I think that's really interesting. If you were to actually build one of these spark gap transmitters and operate it at very high voltages with an induction coil, you would certainly be able to transmit quite far, several kilometers, for example, even at moderate power levels. But if you were to do that, you would certainly violate laws related to allowable output powers of radio transmitters. So if we take a look at some of these transmitter licensing rules, for example, in Singapore, and we look at the line related to the AM radio band, 0.51 to 1.6 megahertz, we can see what the rule is. And the rule is stated as follows. The maximum field strength or output power that your transmitter can supply must be less than 57 dB microvolt per meter at 3 meters. Actually, this is not very much power at all. In other words, without a license, you're not able to transmit very much power. Spark gap transmitters also pollute the radio spectrum because that spark generates radio waves, as you saw, that are not very pure. So let's take a look at Chapter 323, Part 6 of the Telecommunications Act from Singapore, because I think it's really similar to acts all over the world. Any person guilty of an offense under this section shall be liable on conviction to a fine not exceeding $100,000 or to imprisonment for a term not exceeding 3 years or both. In comparison, U.S. law stipulates $10,000 fine or 2 years in prison for operating an unlicensed radio station. The penalties are pretty harsh, so that does show that at least in Singapore and the U.S., these sorts of crimes are looked down upon. It's probably true everywhere else in the world, too.